Hey everyone, I'm Sarah, a 25-year-old graphic designer hustling to make it in the concrete jungle of Chicago. My apartment may be tiny, but it's mine, and I've been grinding hard to save up for something big, a top-tier laptop that'll level up my freelance game. Now let me tell you about my family. It's complicated, especially with my older sister, Emma. She's been a thorn in my side since we were kids, constantly trying to one-up me, greening with envy over every little thing I did. I remember when a school art contest once, and instead of congratulating me, HMA just rolled her eyes. Big deal, anyone can scribble on paper. She said, that's what I dealt with growing up. Hey, Sarah, why don't you show Emma your drawing? My mom would say, oblivious to the tension. Emma would sneer. Yeah, let's see what the little artist can do. And don't even get me started on our parents. Tom and Linda, they practically had a sign on the door saying, Emma's number one fan club. It was always Emma. This Emma that while I was over here working my butt off feeling invisible, Dad, guess what? I try to share something at dinner, but he cut me off. Emma, sweetie. How is school, Emma? With flash a smug smile. Oh, just aced another test. No big deal, but I didn't let it get to me. I kept my head down and worked hard. In the end, it paid off. I landed a scholarship to art school while Emma was still figuring things out when I told her the news. She couldn't believe it. They must be desperate for students. She sneered. I tried not to let it get to me. Fast forward to today, and I finally saved enough to treat myself to a dream. A shiny new MacBook Pro, $33,000 worth of pure graphic design power. The day I hit that order button, I was on cloud nine. You sure about this? Sarah, my best friend Mike asked. That's a lot of cash. I've never been more sure of anything. I told him. This is my moment. My birthday finally arrived, and my family came over for a small celebration. Mom and Dad brought a cake, and even Emma showed up, happy birthday, sis. She said handing me an envelope inside was a $100 gift card. Emma stood there gritting, like she'd just given me a fortune. Wow, thanks, Emma. That's really generous, I said, trying to be nice. Well, you know, I spare no expense for my little sister. She replied with fake sweetness. Then there was a knock at the door, and my heart skipped a beat. I knew what it was. I rushed to the door and came back with a large box. My new laptop, I couldn't hide my excitement as I tore into the box, like a kid on Christmas morning. There it was. Sleek, shiny, and perfect. Isn't it beautiful? I held it up, happying. That's when I noticed Emma's face darkening. How much did that cost? She asked, her voice tight, about 30 grand. I admitted. Her eyes widened in disbelief. $3,000. Who spends that on a laptop? It's for my work, Emma. I've been saving up, I started to explain, but she cut me, off. Oh, all right, your work, she sneered, making air quotes, because little Miss Perfect needs the fanciest toys to DLE on. It's not doodling, Emma. It's graphic design. It's my career. The tension in the room was unbearable. Mom and Dad looked uncomfortable as Emma kept firing off snide comments, each more biting than the last. I noticed she was hitting the wine pretty hard. Refilling her glass again and again must be nice to waste money like that, she slurred. At one point, some of us have to work for a living. You know, I do work, Emma, really hard. Please, sitting around playing on your fancy computer isn't work. I was about ready to snap, but Mom intervened. Girls, please. She said, it's Sarah's birthday. Let's try to get along. As the party began to wind down, I walked Mom and Dad to the door. Thanks for coming, I said, forcing a smile. And thanks for the cake. Of course, sweetie. Happy birthday. Mom replied, giving me a warm hug. I closed the door behind them and took a deep breath. All I had to do was say goodbye to Emma, and this nightmare of a birthday would finally be over. But when I turned back to the living room, Emma wasn't there. I heard a noise coming from my home office. Emma, I called, walking toward the sound when I reached the doorway. I froze. Emma was in my office, stumbling drunk with my toolbox open at her feet, and a hammer in her hand on the desk was my brand new laptop, or what was left of it, Emma. What are you doing? And I screamed. Rushing into the room, she turned toward me, her eyes wild and unfocused. We're even. She slurred, and before I could stop her, she raised the hammer one last time and brought it crashing down on my laptop with a sickening crunch. I stood there paralyzed, staring at the wreckage of my hard-earned dream. Years of saving and work destroyed in a moment of drunken jealousy. The reality of what just happened hit me like a tidal wave, a whirlwind of rage, heartbreak, and an iron determination that this would be the last time Emma ever hurt me. My hand shook as I dialed 911, but by the time I got through to an operator, Emma had already stumbled out of my apartment. I try explaining what happened to the cops, but without her, there it felt pointless. "We'll file a report, Em," the officer said over the phone, but without the suspect present, I knew what that meant. A slim chance of any real justice. I wasn't about to let it end there. I called my parents, hoping they'd back me up. "Mom, Dad, you need to tell the police what Emma did. You saw how she was acting." There was a long pause. Finally, Dad spoke. "Honey, Emma called us earlier. She said she left your party around 8 p.m. We can't lie to the police." My blood ran cold. No, that's not true. She was here. She smashed my laptop. You know how she gets when she drinks." Mom chimed in softly. "Now, Sarah, I think you might be exaggerating. Emma would never do something like that. Maybe you had a little too much to drink yourself." I couldn't believe what I was hearing. My own parents were siding with Emma, again choosing her lies over my truth. "Fine," I said, my voice ice cold. "Believe what you want." I hung up, sinking to the floor, surrounded by the pieces of my shattered dream. But as I sat there, something inside me hardened. I was done being Emma's punching bag. Done with my family's blindness, it was time to expose Emma for who she really was. I called up my best friend, Mike. If anyone could help, it was him. "Mike, I need your help. It's about Emma. What did she do this time?" Mike asked, his voice laced with concern. I filled him in on everything. Mike let have a low whistle. "Damn, Sarah, that's messed up. What do you want to do about it? I want to catch her. Expose her. Make sure everyone sees her for the lying, manipulative person. She really is all right. I mean, what's the plan?" We spent hours brainstorming. Mike's tech skills were going to be key. "First things first," he said, "we need to set up some surveillance in your place. Hidden cameras, mix the works next time Emma comes over. We'll catch everything good." "Idea, what else?" "Well, we'll create a fake social media account to keep tabs on her. I can also do some dating into her digital footprint, maybe even her financials. People like Emma usually have skeletons in their closets. Meanwhile, I have my own role to play. I'll act like I've forgiven her," I said. "I'll get close again." Mike paused. "You sure you can pull that off?" I sigh. "I've been playing nice my whole life." "Mike, I can do it a little longer over the next few weeks. We put our plan into action. Mike helped me install tiny cameras and microphones around my apartment, hidden in picture frames and potted plants. We created a fake Instagram account, Chicago Party Girl, and sent Emma a friend request she accepted. Without hesitation, I reached out to Emma, pretending to be the forgiving sister. Hey, Em, I've been thinking, I'm sorry about how things went down on my birthday. Can we talk?" Her response came quickly. "Sure, sis." "I'm glad you've come to your senses. How Bob dinner? Next week, I have to stop myself from throwing my phone across the room. Instead, I type back, 'Sounds great, can't wait.' And the game was on." Mike was working his magic on the digital front late one evening. He called me, excitement in his voice. "Sarah, you're not going to believe this," he said. "I think I found something big, really big." My heart raced. "What is it?" "I can't say for sure yet, but it looks like Emma might be embezzling from her company. I need to dig deeper. But the numbers don't add up." Shock and a sense of vindication washed over me. This was it. Our way to finally bring Emma down as I prepare for upcoming dinner. A mix of sadness crept in. How had it come to this? My own sister. My own family. But I pushed those feelings aside. Emma had made her choices, and now it was time for her to face the consequences. Little did she know her world of lies was about to crumble, and I would be there to watch it burn. When Emma arrived for dinner, I played the part of the forgiving sister. Hidden cameras were rolling, capturing every word. "Thanks for coming," I said, offering a smile. "I really want us to move past all this. Of course, sis, water under the bridge, right?" she said casually, brushing and off. We made small talk, but I skillfully steered the conversation toward my career. "You know, I've been getting some great freelance gigs lately," I said, watching her expression tighten. "Clients love my work." Emma's jaw clenched. "Oh, aren't you special?" she sneered. "Always the golden child." I push harder. "Remember my birthday? That laptop was supposed to take my career to the next level." Her eyes flared with anger. "You and your stupid laptop," she snapped. "You think you're so much better than me, don't you? Well, I shed you. I smash that thing to pieces and I do it again, bingo." I had her confession on camera. Just then, my phone buzzed. It was Mike. "It's done. We had anonymously tipped off Emma's workplace and the authorities about her embezzlement. Within days, Emma's world imploded. She lost her job, faced criminal charges, and most significantly, our parents finally saw her for who she truly was. The video of her confession went viral, obliterating what remained of her reputation. A week later, I watched from my window as Emma moved out of her upscale apartment, J.B. Blessin, alone. The satisfaction was bittersweet. Her toxicity had finally caught up with her. I turned back to my new laptop, ready to move on with my life and career. For the first time in years, I felt free from Emma's shadow. It was time to focus on my path, leaving behind a resentment and pain as I started a new design project. I couldn't help but smile. This was my fresh start, my chance to shine without Emma's constant attempts to dim my light. The future was bright, and it was all mine. The story is over, but now I've got a question for you. If you were in my shoes, would you have exposed Emma's crimes or tried to help her change? Was justice served, or did I go too far? Drop your thoughts in the comments below. I'm really curious to hear what you would have done in this situation. If you enjoyed this wild ride, don't forget to hit that like button and subscribe for more stories like this. Your support means the world to me and helps the channel grow. Thanks for watching, and I'll catch you in the next one.